I'm Wendy Stapleton and welcome to Wrokdown, coming to you live from Musicland. Well, tonight I don't have a special guest. I have three. Three of the most gorgeous and fun girls in the Australian rock industry. I can say that because I've actually had the pleasure of touring with them. Whoa. And what's on the road stays on the road.
Because we ran over it.
Signed to Mushroom Records in 1986, these girls took the Australian music industry by that storm. Your first single, which was Witch Queen, went straight into the top 10. Would you please welcome the beautiful, delightful Chantoozies? We've got Ali, of course.
Hello.
Evie.
Hello.
And Tottie.
Hello.
And if you're wondering where gorgeous Ange is, she's...
up north.
She's moved.
She flew
breeding.
North.
She's breeding.
She hung up her stilettos for a while and
she has. As I said before, these girls are, seriously, the loveliest and most fun girls to work with. No, really. I mean, a lot of the time you can go on tour with, especially with a group of girls, if you know what I'm talking about, and it can be a little bit... Not so. We've had the best time, but we'll talk about that later. What I want to talk to you about firstly is, A, the fact that you're here tonight because you've released a new single. So this would probably be about your 20th single all up, would it? Or is that an exaggeration?
Might be the 12th.
But what I want to ask straight up is, before the Chantoozies, you were all entertainers and actresses in your own right. Mm-hmm. It appeared to be a group of friends coming together rather than these days where a lot of people, actually producers, audition people and say, I'm going to put together a girl group or a boy group.
The formula thing.
Formula. This wasn't the case, am I correct?
Yeah, there was actually five of us in the beginning.
So who was that?
A girl called Robin Rettig. And we all used to hang together and we're all sort of friends for other people. And we'd get together, I think it was weekly, wasn't it? And just sing 50s and 60s songs and find harmonies and drink champagne, really cheap champagne, and eat cheese and...
And we still drinking really cheap champagne.
We had the idea.
True. And cheese and pan, and we were just having fun.
Yeah,
really.
Well, we were originally going to put together a cabaret show. And in the sort of style of the singlets, does anyone remember the fabulous singlets? And we were going to perform at Kinsella's and those sort of cabaret venues. And then it was Tot's brother that...
Yeah, Brett plays a lot of instruments and he was the bass player in the band. He's buddies with David Rain.
David
the
Rain
Brothers,
yes.
And David became our drummer. And and Frankie McCoy, who was our guitarist, was a buddy. And then they pulled in this guy, Scott, who's on keyboards. So and
yeah, Brett kind of suggested that, you know... Oh, you don't want to do a cabaret act. That's... No, you don't want to do that. That's lame. You want to be a band. So, as Tot said, he put together the band. And
it was... my birthday was coming up and my dad had a club. Well, Brett, our dad had a club called The Underground. And it was huge, right? Do you remember in Melbourne and King Street?
It was massive. There was a queue.
Yeah. Who remembers The Underground?
Yeah, so
and if you weren't from Melbourne, there was a version somewhere else that you could have gone to.
Yeah, I came from Brisbane and Adelaide.
And I was in Adelaide, so I remember the Bombay Bicycle Club. Yeah. And yeah.
People that probably remember The Underground most are the ones that didn't get in. There was a little...
On the little peep tour.
Yeah. So
I'm sure that they used to choose the good lookers to get in.
No, it was no tiaras and no tattoos.
Oh, okay.
So nowadays you're stuffed because... Dad, we talked to Dad and he said, yeah, do it for Tot's birthday. And so we all invited, 150 of our favourite friends. So there were 1,000 people there between the band. And it went off and then Dad gave us a residency. Was it a Wednesday?
Yeah. I think a Wednesday or a Thursday for 6 weeks.
Yeah. Yeah.
And in that time, we were able to get Bob Starkey, who had the club.
Yeah.
Yeah, he came down to see us and various other people came down to see us. Along with David Courtney, who had been sent to see us by Mushroom.
He produced our first single. Long Tall Glasses with the Osea. Remember that song, Long Tall Glasses? Yeah, he wrote that, yeah.
And he produced our first single. So it all sort of, that gave us the platform for people to be able to see us, thanks to Brian.
Your first single, Witch Queen. Well, people in the back of their heads maybe heard it from a long time ago, but it was such a fabulous song, and that went straight up to, I think, got to nationally number four.
Yeah, something
pretty
like
fast.
That. Yeah.
That could have had something to do with us phoning in for our own song. Because there's this thing called the top 8 at 8 and you had to ring in to vote for the song.
No, we did not include that.
So all of us were getting everyone we knew to ring and putting on voices, so we pretty much voted ourselves to the top of that chart.
Tell me a group that didn't do that.
Exactly.
Everybody did that.
Yeah.
So it really was an organic sort of formation. And later on we'll go into all of the different shows that you've done. But just quickly, Ali, you
well,
started.
Well, I was at the time working on Neighbours with your husband.
Up here.
Up here.
He's in the gods. He's like in the gods.
It's like a weird pantomime. You're supposed to be behind me, aren't you?
So, yeah.
Sons and daughters,
and Tot, you did the Henderson kids.
Yeah, I think that was the last thing I'd done, but I'd done Young Doctors and, you know, all of them. You just do. But there was a lot more work around there. Australia was producing a lot more television those days, so you literally bounce. I'd done Prisoner, actually. You bounce from one to the other, to the other, to the other.
And so juggling, and Eve, of course, like later on, one of my favourite movies of all time, Kenny.
Oh, yeah, I was the love interest.
You were
the
love
air hostess.
The air hostess. The
she
gorgeous
was
air hostess.
Jackie, yeah. Your love interest.
Yeah, well, no, I was his love interest.
Oh, speaking of love interest, Phil, you know the beautiful Mick Peeling.
We do. We love Mick.
Mick's part of our Wrokdown crew, Wrokdown Radio, and we have a little segment called Mick's Picks. So Mick basically has chosen a few new releases that he likes to let people know about. So let's take it away with Mick's Picks.
Hey, Wrokdowners, welcome back to Mick's Picks. Today my pick is the fabulous Ryan Adams and his brand new album, probably about his umpteenth album in the last couple of decades. And it's just called Ryan Adams. Now, Ryan started off in the 90s with a band called Whiskey Town, went on to go solo probably about the end of that decade, and has been very, very prolific, sometimes releasing two albums in 1 year. Up until a couple of years ago where he just seemed to stop dead, and he's come out with this one. It's a beauty. It's back, I suppose, to the Whiskey Town sort of style, a bit of country, a bit of Wrok, and just wonderful lyrics. I saw Ryan a couple of years ago when he did a solo show here in Melbourne and was just riveting. It's a great album. Check it out. This is Ryan Adams.
Wrokdown. Welcome back to Wrokdown. My gorgeous guests this evening are the Chantoozies. I'm really liking this shirt.
I had to take my jacket off. Oh, I had to take my jacket off. It's rather warm up here, but thank you.
I'm sure the boys will be very pleased. I did say we'd do a slow reveal.
Yes.
I'll just start rolling my jeans.
I'll undo a shoelace.
So, okay, the success, and it was pretty massive with the Chantoozies because, A, you weren't very hard to look at. On the road, how was that for come on.
Like ducks to water.
But you guys told me I wasn't allowed to tell anybody anything that happened.
No, what
on the
happens
road.
On the road
no, I know,
stays
yeah.
on the road.
No, I know.
Except
but
here on television.
Oh, okay.
Doesn't that payment go in weekly to your bank account?
No, it was great. It was exciting and fun, and it was like being on school camp, but, you know, more grown up.
The experiences,
only just.
The experiences you get offered, like when we went to the Northern Territory, we got taken into experiences that you money can't buy.
Yes.
Going in and, you know, to.
And you didn't even know existed.
Didn't know existed.
Did you tour with David Bowie?
Yes,
we did.
That's
you
an
did
experience
too.
In
oh
itself.
My God,
we did that as
this
well.
Guy. He's a great guy. No, he is a good guy, but I remember flying into the Northern Territory and we had like three Cessnas and one had all the gear and one had people and one had luggage, whatever. And we'd be looking down at this red earth going, where are we going to play? Like there's nothing there. And then some truck would come and pick us up and take us out to an oasis in the middle of nowhere. And it was the most extraordinary experience of our lives. They put us up. We stayed, one time we stayed at the police the policeman's
house? Yeah, we stayed with the police sergeant on an Aboriginal reserve, just
Rick,
out of Catherine.
All those fantastic
and everything that
yeah,
he'd
and we
taken.
Did a music class with all the kids
yeah.
in the next day, and it was great.
And
fun.
Drank cask wine, or everything that he'd taken off the Aboriginals. It's true, though. And then all the fireworks that he'd taken from them.
It was a dry
like
zone.
But we've had a series of extraordinary. I'm telling too much, right? Okay, I'll just shut up right now. Normally we don't shut up, but we're trying not to talk on top of each other.
I haven't said a word.
All right, you talk
no,
about.
No, I've got nothing to say.
We went to Catherine Gorge.
Catherine Gorge, Beswick.
On that particular tour, we were tourists. We were out every day canoeing and kayaking down gorges and climbing rocks, well, the Wrok.
But we had an amazing time, and we still do. And being on the road, to me, is the best part of it.
Yeah,
and your fan base hasn't diminished.
Because half of them are dead, I think.
Oh, stop it. Before we go any further, I've got to do this because I'm afraid I'm going to forget to do it. But this is really beautiful. It's a letter from all the way from Scotland, a gorgeous girl who obviously you... Do you know her personally? Or
no, I don't know her. I think she saw my work in Wentworth and she became a bit of a fan, I guess.
A Simo
is that the
fan.
Right word? But a Simo fan.
I'm going
right.
to give this to you quickly.
I can't read my own letter.
I'll read it.
No, not your own letter. That's from her.
Oh.
This is beautiful.
Do you want me to read
you
it?
You can read that.
Hello, I'm a fan in Scotland and unfortunately can't make it to Oz for the recording. Could you please give Ali and the girls a little message from me when they are on your show? I'd just love to let them know
of
all the love and support they're getting overseas and how much they've helped me through. Please let Ali know that I got the card she sent me at Christmas and that I love her lots. I was looking into flights to come over for the recording, but unfortunately I was too late. This will mean more to me than you will ever know. Thank you very much, Jamie Bell.
Aww. Isn't that beautiful?
Oh, that's beautiful.
Thank
that's
you, Jamie.
Thanks, Jamie.
That's absolutely gorgeous. So anyway, what we'll do is we'll make sure that Jamie gets a little...
Yeah.
Somehow get a little copy through whatever the magic things you do on TV these days. What
that's
do you do?
Right.
Stream it or...
And Jamie's actually filmed with it singing Wanna Be Up to Her Sister. She did you see that post?
No.
Pretty funny.
Yeah, well, we're going to have a look at a new film clip, a new clip by Sisters Doll. The song is called Doll House, or that could be the other way around. It's right? Let's have a look at this.
Shake, so hold on dear, 'cause we're getting out of here. Welcome to the dollhouse. doors locked tight. Keeping it sealed, keeping it sealed. I guess they're making us live in sin. Keeping it sealed, keeping it sealed. I guess they're making us live in sin. Welcome to the dollhouse. Are you ready to play tonight? Welcome to the dollhouse. You're not leaving.
Welcome back to Wrokdown, the segment that we all love because she's always out and about. Would you welcome the gorgeous Soozie Pinder?
Hello, everybody. Hello, Wen. How you going, darling?
Always in something stunning. We always just do a little bit of a fashion thing first.
Just a little bit of bling.
Just be a bit girly and just check out what you've got on. Can we have a look at the shoes, please?
Bit of bling. I actually put fake tan on because my legs look like prosthetics. They haven't seen the sun for that long. But the fake tan only goes to there, so I just got worried then.
Well, gorgeous as usual. So what have you been up to, Suze?
Oh, when I've been running amok. I've been running around town. I'm taking off for something really, really special on Friday morning. LJ and I are heading over to Adelaide because Mick Peeling, who you know,
that how gorgeous
we saw
Mick.
There, Mick's picked. Well, I look after Mick, and he's
do
been...
you?
Yes. Not that way.
Did you hear that, Lawrence?
He's used to a wife swap. He's going to swap. He's going to take Mick's partner. No. He's nominated into the South Australian Musical Hall of Fame with Mel and Stars. And it's a big night on Friday night, so we're going to fly over and Greg's going to be there, Greg, our floor manager, Chrissy Jackson, one of our regulars, are flying over to see it too. So it's thrilling and I'm so excited.
Well, I wish I could be there and I'm a bit... Of course you've got a new dress for it. So who have you got for us tonight? This is amazing.
Absolute pleasure of being at Rockberry Jam and Daryl Braithwaite was there. And it was so nice because he's really quite interesting. Did you know he was a twin? I didn't know.
No.
I'm the mum of twin boys, so I think it's in the interview. If not, I'll tell you about it later. But he actually did the Kokoda track and he walked it and he said it was the most humbling experience. If he had have known how difficult it was, he wouldn't have probably...
Everybody says that.
It was mind-blowing. Yeah.
Everybody says the same thing, that you think you're going to get fit and do this... trick, but once you're there, the heat and just the amount of walking that you have to do every day and the mountains, it's all through mountains.
But there's no saying, I don't want to do it.
I want to go home.
Imagine if you were the one that you'd said to everyone, I can't do this. Mm. You know, they throw eggs at you or something. But he's great. And he actually loves ironing. Daryl Braithwaite loves ironing. I know. I said, well, I can help you out there because I've got a couple of baskets at home. Because I don't love ironing. Do I, Lawrence?
Very unusual hobby for a pop singer, isn't it?
Yeah, he's pretty cool. Will we have a look? Let's have a look at the interview.
Daryl Braithwaite.
How are you, Daryl?
Good. She found me just wandering around the car park.
I did. He was lost. He had a map. Hey, you're a twin.
Yeah. Glenn, my brother. Yeah. And he lives in Geelong.
Did he sing?
Yeah. He's still... he's a professional by trade. He's a pathologist, works with blood, he was head of the blood bank in Geelong. And he did singing in a band on and off, you know, weekends and all that sort of stuff for He's still doing it now, so yeah.
Is he the oldest or you?
No, I am, by 15 minutes.
I'm the mum of twins, so I've got a passion for twins.
Oh, there you go.
They're damn good. Yeah. So you're only 21 when you were in Sherbet?
Yeah, it would have been 49. Yeah, just turned 21, yeah.
How was that for a 21-year-old?
Well, it was good, except for when I told mum and dad that I was joining a band to go professional and that I'd get paid every week, like, you know, $1.50 or something. Dad was really upset, but, you know, it was an exciting start to... Well, we didn't know what was going to happen, you know, no one does, and it was amazing that still doing it, whatever it is now, 45 years later.
I knocked off your red gym boot, your Converse gym boots at Festival Hall. You had red ones. And
did you?
I was there, and someone dragged you, so I dragged you by the foot, and your shoe come off.
Right.
People chased me down the street for the bloody shoe. So you were in the rock opera Tommy?
Yeah, God. Yeah, back in 1970, I think 74, with, you know, Jimmy Keys and Doug Parkinson, Broderick Smith, Keith Moon, and a lot of, you know, Ian Meldrum was in there as well. That was a great experience, you know, like being with them, because they were all the, I guess, the artists that have been successful in Melbourne had started to be, and us being in Sherbet, or me, we were trying to break into Melbourne at that stage, and it was hard going, but I think that sort of opened the door a little bit, you know, to break into Melbourne, because Melbourne still is the probably the capital of the rock music.
Did you always think you were going to be involved in music? Is that something that you always thought you were going to do?
No, not... well, I never thought that I would be involved in it as what I am now. I think we were doing it as a hobby right up till, you know, joining Sherbet, and never really had any intentions of doing it seriously, you know, but it just... I think it just kept getting better and more enjoyable. And then, you know, when they said, well, it's professional, so you can't do anything else. And I went, oh, wow, okay, that's great. Wonder what that means, really. But, yeah, and you have no knowledge of how far it's going to go or if you're going to be successful or... But it's purely, I think, why we did it. All the people in Sherbet was just that it was a lot of fun.
You still ironing? I spoke to you and you told me you like to iron.
I still love ironing. I've ironed my black t-shirt that's over there.
You're remarkable. The ideal man, he irons.
Yeah. Yeah, I make a good catch, you know, good husband. Yeah.
So it's your first year at Rockberry Jam. Yeah. It's an awesome event.
It looks lovely. I've only been here maybe 15, 20 minutes. Haven't been outside. I'm about to go out there and have a look. And, looking forward to it.
Little local footy club wanted to raise some funds and they put it on themselves, mortgaged their houses.
How many years have they been...
This is just the second year.
Oh, okay, great.
And phenomenal success.
Good. Well, hey, we'll give it our all and we'll look forward to it.
Yeah. Hey, so good talking to you.
Thank you.
Really, really wrapped. And good to see you, and I'll give you your shoe back.
Thank you. Yeah, right? One day.
Yeah, one day.
Okay.
Thanks, Daryl.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Bye-bye.
Over and out, Wrokdown. He's just a lovely man. There's no ease and graces with him. He was great fun. And his voice is phenomenal. To this day, he has lost none of the quality of his voice. He just real good fun. And I did knock off the red gym boot. And my mate knocked it off. And we were at Festival Hall and we were about 14. And Stevie Wright was on the bill too. And we ran down the street with all these young girls chasing us, wanting to kill us for the gym boot. It was like the life of Brian, you know, and we've got it. Bright red cons.
Oh, that's fantastic. As you were saying, like, this was
Rockberry Jam. That's the event that is put on by the local footy club to raise money. And, you know, the berries are made up in Wandon, where it is. So look out for it, because it's around, I think, March each year, I think. It's hot when it's on. And it is really good value for money. And they had Joe Camilleri and... Oh, I can't think who else. Oh, John Stevens. And that was...
Fabulous John, yeah.
Oh, he was remarkable too. So it's a great festival. Really, really well run by a local footy club.
Good on you, Suze. Always out and about.
Yeah, having fun, having
so
fun.
So apart from the weekend coming up, you're going to Adelaide to see the boys being inducted into the Hall of Fame.
Yeah.
Have a beautiful time in Adelaide.
I will win. I'm so thrilled.
And give everyone our love, especially congratulations to Mick. Yeah. Because he deserves it. He's a wonderful artist. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you.
And we'll talk next week.
Yes.
The gorgeous Suzie Pinder.
Thank you.
Wrokdown.
Welcome back to Wrokdown. They're incorrigible. The Chantoozies. Well, as you probably heard, I was just talking to the gorgeous Suzie Pinder, and she's just interviewed Daryl Braithwaite, and I said, we've got a funny little story.
Oh,
now, he's gorgeous. We all did the countdown tour together.
There were like, what, 100
well, there were 80 acts.
Yeah.
That was bands included, like some
yeah.
Some of the, did anyone go? To the first one, in it was 2000 and...
Yeah, the second one wasn't as good.
Yep.
Yeah.
All up there were 80 artists, and then there was the 80 crew. So consequently, as we were saying earlier, that they had to move 180 people.
In alphabetical order. I sat next to Les Gock every single trip because of Goldsmith. Gone.
And I was between John English and... Oh, I can't remember. Oh, James Freud, I think.
There you go. Oh. Evie, who are you next to?
I was flying the plane.
Actually, one beautiful little segment.
Yeah.
Before we get into our what happened backstage, which started at the very beginning of the tour, one gorgeous little situation was we were all flying from Adelaide to Perth, and all on the one plane. And so there we all were getting onto the plane, and Frank Holden, I could tell he was up to a little bit of mischief up the front of the plane.
Always up to mischief.
But what he'd actually done was we hadn't seen Kenny, none of us had seen Kenny, the movie. And Frank had found out that Eve had a big part in this movie. So he organised a copy, and the crew, the plane crew, put the movie on for us to all watch it. And we didn't know that Eve was in it until she's on the screen. She's Kenny's girlfriend. That was a beautiful moment on the plane. That was really lovely. But I'll set the story up and then you girls can take it away. We started in Newcastle.
Yes.
And of course, what you forget as on stage is that the screen is as big as the stage. It was absolutely massive. So the girls always do their makeup and their hair. You know, it's something that we just always do. But boys don't always think about things like that. And to not be too cruel, some people
they weren't young anymore.
Some of them looked like they'd walked all the way. Let's just say that. So no one was catching a cab.
Mm-mm. So it started off with Brian Mannix because, of course, Brian's never sort of shy about putting a little bit of makeup on. So Brian was the first one into the girls' dressing room. And I was in Neighbours and my name was Trixie Tucker. I was Delta Goodham's mum, so I was Trixie, and you were Trixie.
And when I did Young Doctors, I was Trixie Sheldon.
So in our girls' dressing room, because we're all together, we opened up, what was it called?
Trixie Salon.
Trixie Salon.
Trixie Salon. You girls take it away. One by one, every boy except Daryl Braithwaite was conned into coming into Trixie.
Well, not conned. They started lining
they
up.
They were begging for it.
We had to end up writing
makeup.
A schedule to get them to come in, because once I said, your paws can be seen on the screen, they're like, getting in the room. But we started scheduling them in, and we used your, what was your bronzer called? That
Natural Blur.
Natural Blur. Yeah, and Brian Mannix's Black Coal.
Black Eyeliner, that's
Black
right.
Eyeliner.
And
the bags. He said, what about the other?
Yeah,
think we ended up going to buy some makeup, didn't we, at some point, some base or something so that we could
I had
use
a stick, like a theatre stick.
Especially on the boys, so it didn't come near the lady.
But Stephen Cummings didn't leave the girls' room. He was on the couch.
But he was more in for emotional counselling and just, you know, having a chat.
He
wasn't in so much for the makeup.
But once they got into the makeup thing and, you know, became conscious of themselves on the screen, it was really like, it was like a job for us, wasn't it?
It was full on.
And then they wanted spray can hair.
I did say to Brian Canham, hi, Brian, we might get you a little bit of brown hairspray because the cameras are up high.
We'll get your hat.
He does. He wears a hat all the time now.
He does now. Brian. We love you, Brian. No, we do.
Yeah, I made him a backstage video or film.
I want to see it.
I will give
we
you
all
a
want
copy.
To see it, don't we?
Yeah. It is very funny because especially
who do we have to influence?
Well, we have to kill Michael Gudinski, and he's got out of the way, and then
everyone else has tried. We can give it a go.
No, but what was really interesting in making that film was that, like, I didn't know a lot of the people very well. We all knew each other through the industry, you know, over time and stuff, but no one knew each other very well. And I had this camera, and as soon as everyone sees the camera, they're like, oh, I'm not, yeah, don't, no, I don't want to be on. And by the end of the tour, everyone's like, you got any footage of me? And then they all, you know, lined up.
Apart from Frankie Holden, who starred in it.
He just stole the show.
There were two people that probably weren't going to go anywhere near our salon. Daryl was the last person who, he actually didn't do it. But James Rain was really funny because he kept hovering.
Yeah, hovering, seriously.
What are you doing? Do you want to come in? No. No. What are you doing? And then, of course, I think someone told him that...
I told him that his pores were really big on the screen and that come in and get a bit of putty filler. So in he was. He just wouldn't let me do mascara on him. I'm going, James, come on, your eyes will just pop. But he wouldn't be part of that.
Oh, things popped, but it wasn't his eyes. Okay.
And it was dry. Oh, that's another thing. It was dry backstage. So we weren't allowed to drink because they had to get through however many acts there were. So there were brown paper bags being
smuggled
in and out. So when I saw Wilbur nearly fall backwards out of a bus, I realised...
on top of Renee.
On top of Renee.
Renee clearly, someone slipping something into the...
Yeah.
Oh, it was funny. We've got to go to a clip. The beautiful Pip Joyce, who...
We all know Pip.
He
gorgeous.
Plays with Glenn Shorrock. Yeah. He has a film clip, and I'm just going to check the name here because I've forgotten it. It's called Catcher in the Rye. So let's have a look at Pip. We'll be back soon.
Since the day that you were born, catcher in the rye, stalking your prey, seeking immortality on that fateful day. Four shots, he's dead. Three in the heart, and one through the head. A shot in the dark, across Central Park. The bullets burned, they still burn, and they always will. Capture in the rye, seeding through your core, on a date with destiny, since the day that you were born. Sirens in the air, flashing out blood red. Carry on. Shot in the dark, across Central Park. The mourners kneel, they still kneel, and they always will. Since the day that you were born.
shots. He's dead. Three in the heart and one through the head. Shout in the dark across Central Park. The bullets burn. They still burn. And they always will. The mourners kneel. They still kneel. And they always will. Capture
in the rye.
Seeding through your core.
Seeding through your core.
On a date with destiny.
On a date with
since
destiny.
Day that you were born.
Since day that you were born.
Sirens in the air.
Sirens in the air.
Flashing out the bridge.
Welcome back to Wrokdown. I'm with the Chantoozies, and you just heard it from the inside, backstage at Countdown.
Oh, yeah, hot.
Yeah, and it's
this was the story.
It.
Next, it'll be the movie.
Oh, yeah.
That's right.
If we can get away with that. Yeah. Anyway, look, all of those funny stories that we would love to go on with. Serious business, girls, because you have a new single out.
Yeah.
We do.
It's Black and Blue, and you wrote it.
I wrote this one.
Tell us about it.
I actually wrote it years and years ago. I had a bit of a hiatus from the band, and I was I'd been writing lyrics for ages, and I ended up in New York, and through a long story, got together with a guy called Gus Till, who was one of the musicians from Max Q, which was Michael Hutchins' other band, and which was kind of pushed down by the management because it was going to supersede In Excess. So anyway, he was in New York at the time, and Ollie Olsen as well, and we were all hanging out together. And before I knew it, I'm in a studio with a guy called Todd Terry, who's an amazing producer and like massive in the DJ world now. And we got down and wrote some songs, and to cut a very long story short, they kind of went missing in action. I got back to Australia and started getting jobs in all sorts of industry stuff, and then they ended up in
A garage
covered in dust. And I'm saying to the girls, I wonder, I should try and get these, see if they still exist, because it's the odd analogue, you know, the reel-to-reel. Mm-hmm. So there's quite a process that you go through, which is they have to put it into an oven and bake it. And if you're fortunate enough for it to come out to the other side,
Luckily, you're a really good cook.
Lucky I'm a really good cook. So out of the, I don't know, five songs or whatever, we sort of decided amongst us that this was the one that suited the Chantoozies best, and let's chuck it out and get our iPhones out and shoot a film clip and see what happens.
Touring, dates, et cetera, et cetera. What do you have in the pipeline?
Look, we're sort of all over the place.
Just for a change.
But I think the next lot of gigs we've got coming up are in Sydney. We go to Darwin actually at the end of September. And we're playing at a fabulous function up there for the Carers Association of Northern Territory. But then we're Etalong and Richmond in Sydney, 2nd and 3rd of October. But our website has all our dates on it.
So we can check all
of that
out.
So does our Facebook page. Go on and like us. We're a little bit needy. So next year, October next year.
Oh, is it next year?
Yeah.
2016.
I could still get on.
You could still get on, Wendy.
Come on with us.
We're all going on this big cruise called the Wrok Cruise or the Cruise.
It's Radiance of the Sea.
What's it called?
And it's Cruise and Groove.
Oh, Cruise and Groove. It's even better than I thought.
Come Cruise and Groove. Come Cruise and Groove.
I didn't know about this one.
And there's 80 million bands on it. And
Fonzie.
Fancy.
JPY.
My brother-in-law is a ship's captain for P&O. He won't be captaining that particular ship.
Oh,
I love what you do.
But I know all about a bit of cruising.
I love what you do when you go on those cruises with him, because I asked you, how do you spend your time? And you said to me...
Oh, well, I spend a lot of time in my sister's cabin.
No.
Oh, where do I spend my time?
At the bar. And you said you make your way through the cocktail list through the colours. You start at red right. and you end on green.
And I've got a little tip for you. Don't leave the spooky colours to the end. You've got to do the shocking cocktails first. Get them over and done with, out of the way. Because there's about sort of 40 of the things on the... But, you know, it, an amateur, when I first did it, went, all right, I'm working through the list. And I went for all the things that you kind of like a pina colada, a margarita. And then at the end, there were these spooky, psycho pink and blue and horrible things, so sweet and sickly. And by that point, I was so hungover. And I'm going, all right. Oh. Awful. Anyway.
We did go on a boat, right? What was it?
The Achille Lauro.
Ooh.
That was our
the
first...
The America's Cup.
I fell into the toilet. I was trying to look at my outfit up on the toilet, and I had to stand on the toilet seat to try and see my outfit in the mirror, and it broke. And I fell in my stick.
Lucky it's not one of those ones like they have in a plane where you go...
Yeah.
could have been very nasty.
And
where does it go?
We used to sunbathe.
I'm never eating fish again.
I was an awful thought. I was so...
On that note...
I was so bored I took to plucking my legs.
Yeah, but we did that on deck. Remember?
The Italian
doctor fell in love with you and he wrote you a little love note and he said, Tottie, you are hot to trot. You're like a red Ferrari.
Or like Ginger Rogers and Fred Astaire.
He had this writing.
He was so freaky.
And you flashed Dennis Connor. Was he the captain of the America's... The American... Yeah.
And someone had got shot on it in a wheelchair?
No, that was way
that was
before.
Awful. Honestly, between you two are just...
who flashed Dennis Connor?
She did. She was on the bow of the ship.
Did that?
What did I do?
I suspect that's why we lost.
Oh, I did too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Remember they were tacking and they did the spectacular tack on the bow of the ship.
And I did a flash.
And Tottie went, oh!
Well, John Farnham mooned us.
He did moon
us. Yeah, but that wasn't on the cruise.
That was on the way to the airport.
He was in a limousine and we're in like a Tarago.
We were on a unicycle. All on top of each other.
Chantoozies, and he's in a big stretch limo and he mooned us out the window.
I'm not sure whether to ask whether that was good or...
It was so funny.
It was before he retired.
Yeah. and it was younger. He was in better form, so to speak.
Oh, this is too much fun. Look, unfortunately, we've got to wrap up. So we're going to...
What before we get hooked off?
Well, we could stay here, but haven't you got to go somewhere?
Yeah, oh, no, I cancelled that. It was just a bloke and a cocktail and a plate of cheese.
Before the show, Tottie said, I thought we were only doing one segment. I've got to meet this bloke. You're on for the whole show.
I am crying.
You do this
I love
to me
you, girl.
Every time.
As I said at the beginning of the show, you've got to go on tour. Well, you can't, but I can.
Yeah,
with
come
these
with
girls.
Us,
yeah,
Wendy.
Will you invite me? Get me on it. Get me on it.
Because coming to a gig's a bit like being
on the road with us.
On the
just
road
goes
with us.
On and on and on.
Exactly.
Would
we
you
once
please?
Did a show that was 3 hours long in Kalgoorlie.
She's trying to get a word.
Oh,
that's
sorry.
All right. It's all right. We're going to leave you all, our beautiful audience, with your clip.
Yay!
Black and blue. But before we do anything else, would you please thank these beautiful girls, Ali, Evie, and Tottie. Beautiful Soozie.
Thank
Binder,
you, Wendy.
Our gorgeous crew and all the staff here. Thank you so much. We're going to leave you with Black and Blue. Good night. See you next time.